Okay, so we will start now immunology. This is one of the most difficult section to understand. So the concepts of immunology is actually you have to understand and remember. Just like that, if you read, then it will not enter inside. Okay, and if you are thorough in immunology, then you are it will help you even post PG also. Any PG you take, the concepts of immunology will be useful in understanding the pathogenesis of any diseases. Okay, so let us start the first chapter, immunity. Immunity is defined as the resistance offered by the host against foreign infection, either infection or any foreign body. This resistance what the host offers against the foreign infection, it may be there right from the birth, called as innate immunity, or it may be acquired during the course of the life, called as acquired immunity. So innate immunity is the immunity which is present right from the birth, whereas acquired immunity, or also called as adaptive immunity, is an immunity which we usually acquire during the course of the life. What are the differences between innate and acquired immunity? Innate immunity, the prior sensitization to antigen is not required, whereas acquired immunity, there should be a prior sensitization to antigen. When the antigen is present for the first time or in the subsequent time, the innate immunity is same, the response of innate immunity is same, whereas acquired immunity is totally different. When the antigen is exposed for the second time, subsequent time, the acquired immunity is much faster. This is because of the memory component. Memory component is absent in innate immunity, whereas it is present in acquired immunity. Because of the memory component, the secondary immune response in innate immunity, it is same as primary, whereas in acquired immunity, it is always faster than the primary immunity. And innate immunity, the receptor interaction, innate immunity, they say that the receptors of innate immunity, like pattern recognition receptor, especially host receptors, I am telling about. So the host receptors are pattern recognition receptors. Example is toll-like receptor. So these receptors are non-specific. Innate immunity is always non-specific. These toll-like receptors can bind to many molecules present on the microbial surface, whereas acquired immunity is always specific. There is specific response of receptors are involved, like for example T cell receptor and B cell receptor. So this T cell receptor and B cell receptors are highly specific. For every antigen, for every epitope of an antigen, there is a T cell receptor, there is a B cell receptor. They are highly coordinated, highly specific in their action. Whereas innate immunity is quite non-specific. The toll-like receptors are the host cell receptors for innate immunity, and they are broad in their action. They have a broad, they can bind to any kind of bacterial molecules. The spectrum is always narrow for innate immunity. They say that innate immunity is available only against a restricted range of pathogen, whereas acquired immunity has a broad range it can cover any kind of pathogen. If a new pathogen will be introduced to the community, then only against that also you will have a T cell and a B cell. They are highly coordinated. Let us discuss the examples of innate and acquired immunity component. This is again very important, because in the exam they usually ask, this is the aspect what they ask, component of innate and acquired immunity. Acquired immunity, as I told, the specific cells like T cell, B cell. Whereas innate immunity, non-specific components like phagocytes like neutrophil, basophil, eosinophil, as well as macrophages, then complement pathway in general, they are component of innate immunity, but if you classify to be very particular, they say that alternate pathway and mannose binding pathway, these two pathway are a component of innate immunity, whereas classical pathway belongs to acquired immunity. There involves antibody involvement. So other than that, normal flora of the body, skin and mucosal barrier, fever and inflammatory barrier, whenever any infection occurs against which the inflammation takes place and fever may develop. So all these are non-specific components. And don't forget natural killer cells. NK cells are the most important examples of innate immunity. Acute phase reactant protein. Again, mast cell and dendritic cells. Okay, so you have to tell me now, all these components are specific or non-specific? Innate immunity, those components are non-specific in their action. Any infection occurs, the NK cells will be recruited. They are not specific in their action. In contrast, the T cell, B cell, the classical complement pathway, and also the APCs. APC stands for antigen presenting cells. They are component of acquired immunity. They are specific in their action. They are component of acquired immunity. So with this context, let us start the two variety of the two divisions of acquired immunity. Acquired immunity can further be classified into active immunity and passive immunity. Active immunity, they say that the host immune response is actively involved. Whereas passive immunity, you are receiving ready-made antibody from the external source. The host immune response is not actively involved. What are the examples? Active immunity can be natural active immunity. Example, following infection. Or it could be artificial active immunity. Example, following vaccination. Both these conditions, the body's immune system is actively involved. Whereas natural passive immunity is which antibody transfer? From mother to fetus, IgG. And artificial passive immunity is all kind of immunoglobulins, like human rabies immunoglobulin, human tetanus immunoglobulin. So immunoglobulins are example of artificial passive immunity. What are the differences? Before we discuss our differences, I will tell you the two variety of the two divisions of active immunity. Active immunity can occur following primary exposure to antigen, which is called as primary immune response. or active immunity which develops following subsequent antigenic challenge is called a secondary immune response. This difference is based on whether the antigen is exposed for the first time or for the subsequent time. The response is same or different? Different. How they are different? When the antigen is exposed for the first time, antibody will be produced immediately or after some time. Antibody will produce after some time. First you need a lag phase, where in the lag phase the T and B cells will be stimulated. The T and B cells will be stimulated and they will be sensitized against the antigen. After that the 5% of T and B cell will become memory cells, and the 95% of T and B cell will be involved, they will be affected cell and they will be involved to produce antibody in the next phase, that is exponential phase or log phase. This is a phase where the antibodies will start producing. After some time the antibody level will be constant, it will be constant, flat for some time, then the antibody level will fall down and in the serum maybe a baseline antibody will be maintained. After the infection is over, you will be knowing that always IgG antibodies, some baseline antibodies will be remaining. What happens when the antigen occurs for the subsequent time? Do you need a lag phase? No, the lag phase is not required because the memory cells are active, they will produce antibody immediately. Instead of lag phase, they say that you will have a negative phase. What do you mean by negative phase? They say that when the antigen is exposed for the subsequent time, the antigen binds with the preformed serum antibody. What is the baseline serum antibody will be there. The antigen will bind to the baseline serum antibody and those antibodies will be utilized. As a result, for some time it will appear that antibody level is falling down from the serum, which is soon followed by activation of the memory cells and the antibody level will again start rising. And please remember, the secondary antibody titer is more or less than the primary antibody titer. It is always more than the primary antibody titer. That is why they say that the booster doses are useful in secondary, active immunity. Booster doses, why we give? Because the secondary immune response is much more higher than the primary immune response. And one more difference is the antibody type is usually IgM type in primary response, whereas the secondary immune response, the antibody type is IgG type. So where you have a lag phase will be there in primary immune response. Negative phase will be there in secondary immune response. And how the passive immunity is different than active immunity? Passive immunity, there is no lag phase, there is no negative phase, the memory also is absent, there is no memory response at all, and booster doses are not useful. You are just receiving ready-made antibodies. They will act as, just like antibiotics. When you take antibiotic, only that particular time it will work. Okay? So these are the, but passive immunity has its own importance. Though it is not much useful, but in certain situations it is useful. Like for example, in immunodeficiency individuals. To provide fetal immunity. Fetus is also immunologically, it is primitive. Hence maternal antibodies will really help to provide immunity against infections to fetus. And also when you need an immediate response, because for active immunity you need a lag phase. If you have exposure to some organism, some infection, so you need immediate protection. So for post exposure prophylaxis. So these are the conditions where passive immunity plays a important role. Passive immunity plays an important role. Okay. So I'll tell you a little bit about acute phase reactant protein. What is APR? APR are the acute phase reactant protein produced by liver, mainly by liver, maybe by other organs, but mainly by liver. Against what? Against acute inflammation. They are the marker of acute inflammation, which could be infective, which could be non-infective also. Can you tell me some non-infective conditions where APRs will be raised? Acute myocardial infection, rheumatoid arthritis, like that, various non-specific, non-infectious conditions are there where APRs will be raised. So these APRs are usually positive APRs, that is, they are raised in acute inflammation. Examples of positive APR like C-reactive protein, amyloid protein, mannose binding protein, mannose binding protein. Okay, metal binding protein. Complement factors, coagulation factors, all these are the various proteins which are raised in acute inflammation. Remember, there are some proteins which can be decreased in acute inflammation, which are called as negative APR. These proteins, they decrease in acute inflammation. Examples, albumin. Pre-albumin, transferrin, histidine-rich glycoprotein, histidine-rich glycoprotein. Fine. So this is all. These are positive APR and negative APR. A bit about C-reactive protein. Why it is called a C-reactive protein? Because it is reactive to the carbohydrate antigen of pneumococcus. But please remember, it is non-specific. It is a non-specific protein. It is not an antibody against pneumococcus. Just it is reactive, but it is not an antibody. Okay? And it belongs to beta globulin family. CRP belongs to beta globulin family. They say that the normal level will be less than 0.2 milligram per deciliter, and it is raised. They say that the marginally it will be raised that is around 1 milligram per deciliter in various conditions like exercise, pregnancy, etc. Moderate raise, that is 1 to 10 milligram per deciliter, is an acute myocardial infection. And it is marked raised more than 10 milligram per deciliter. This usually happens in infectious conditions. Infectious conditions. Okay. And they say that there are certain tests, that is, CRP is detected by CRP is detected by usually by lactase agglutination test. and it has a detection limit of 0.6 milligram per deciliter. Lattice agglutination test, it has a detection limit of 0.6 milligram per deciliter. However, the lower level of CRP can be detected by a test which is called as ultra sensitive CRP. Ultra sensitive CRP, these are the low level of CRP can be detected by various enzyme immunoassay methods. The routinely done detection method is lattice agglutination test, which has a detection limit of 0.6 milligram per deciliter. However, if you want to detect, because there are various conditions where the CRP will be low, I mean moderately raised or marginally raised, those conditions, if you do an enzyme immunoassay method, then you can detect ultra sensitive CRP, that is low level of CRP also can be detected. Okay, fine. So can you tell me now a little bit about herd immunity and local immunity? What is local or mucosal immunity? It is the immunity present at the mucosal sites, which prevent the immunity is mediated by secretory IgA antibodies, and the secretory IgA antibodies are induced by either live infection or live vaccination. So that is why the live vaccines are always better than the inactivated vaccine, because they can induce the production of secretory IgA antibodies. What is herd immunity? Herd immunity is again the overall immunity of a community towards a pathogen. So it is the overall immunity of a community towards a pathogen. If the herd immunity is good, if the herd immunity is strong, then eradication is possible. And epidemic also can be ceased. They say that there is strong herd immunity towards a pathogen is important to reduce the epidemics, and eradication also can be possible. There are various vaccines which can induce herd immunity. Like for example, MMR, measles, mumps, rubella. Then in DPT, diphtheria and pertussis vaccine. Of course, don't forget the most important example is OPV, we have discussed yesterday. OPV can induce herd immunity. Smallpox vaccine. Okay, so these are the examples of vaccines that can induce herd immunity. Okay, so this finishes the first chapter. Then we discuss second chapter. This chapter is about antigen antibody, antigen antibody reaction, complement. So all these are the topics which will be covered in this. Coming to the first topic, antigen. Antigen is any substance that satisfies two property. Antigen is any substance that satisfies two important property. One is immunogenicity, other one is immunological reactivity. Immunogenicity is ability of an antigen to induce antibody production, to stimulate the immune system to produce antibody. Whereas immunological reactivity is ability of an antigen to react with the antibody. There are various reactions like precipitation, agglutination. So, ability of the antigen to react with an antibody. defective antigen. So why they are defective antigen is they lack immunogenicity. However, they retain immunological reactivity. The lack immunogenicity means they cannot stimulate antibody production. However, if the antibodies are ready made available, they can bind. They can bind. They can bind either in an observable way or in a non-observable way. Simple heptanes are non-precipitating in nature, whereas complex heptanes are precipitating in nature. Simple heptanes cannot bind, simple heptanes can bind, but you cannot visualize the reaction, whereas complex heptanes, you can visualize the heptan antibody reaction. They say that for to become a complex heptan, at least two epitopes it should contain. It should contain at least two epitopes to become a complex heptan. What is the epitope, by the way? Epitope is nothing but it is the smallest antigenic determinant. It is the smallest antigenic determinant that binds to specific part of antibody, which is called as paratope. It is the smallest antigenic determinant, it is the smallest unit of the antigen that binds to the specific part of antibody. Okay, so this is all about epitope. Then the factors influencing antigenicity. There are various factors that can influence antigenicity, such as size of the antigen. Larger the size, more is the antigenicity. Larger the size, more is the antigenicity. Chemical nature. They say that proteins are highly antigenic, followed by carbohydrate, followed by lipid, followed by nucleic acid. Proteins are highest antigenic. Then susceptibility to tissue enzyme. Here they say that if the antigen is degradable by tissue enzyme, then that leads to generation of more number of epitopes. If the antigen is degradable by tissue enzyme, more number of epitopes will be produced. More number of epitopes will be exposed, and that leads to increased antigenicity. Latex, for example, latex is chemically inert. It is not degradable by tissue enzyme, and that is why latex cannot induce antigenicity, and that is the reason why latex is used as a carrier particle over which antigen antibody reaction can take place. Okay. Then also foreignness of the antigen. There are various other factors. Foreignness of the antigen. Increase the foreignness, increase more is the antigenicity. Increase in the foreignness of the antigen, more is the antigenicity. Heterophile nature of the antigen. There are various heterophile antigens are there. What do you mean by heterophile antigen? They say that cross reactive antigens. There are many antigens which share their epitopes, and this property can be exploited to detect antibodies by using a different antigen. For example, Weil Felix test and Paul Bunnell test. Weil Felix test, you are detecting rickettsial antibody, by using protease antigen. Paul Bennett-Lys, it is done in infectious mononucleosis. So the non-specific antibodies are detected against the sheep RBC antigen. Non-specific antibodies are detected against sheep RBC antigen. Like that, there are so many other heterophile antigen-antibody reactions, cold agglutination test, mycoplasma MG test. Both these tests are done in mycoplasma. So, you are detecting non-specific antibodies of mycoplasma by using different antigens. For example, in cold agglutination test, human ORBCs are used. Human ORBCs are used. Mycoplasma MG antigen, streptococcus, this test is called as mycoplasma MG or streptococcus MG antigen, because here streptococcus MG is used as a antigen. So, streptococcus MG test. Here streptococcus MG, which is an example of group F streptococcus, this is used as an antigen, but it is used to detect mycoplasma antibody. Yesterday we have discussed VDR. VDR is what antigen you use? Cardiolipin antigen, specific or non-specific? Non-specific. Non-specific bovine hat antigen. Okay, so all these are example of various heterophile agglutination, heterophile antigen antibody reactions. One more heterophile antigen is Fostman antigen. Fostman antigen is an example of universal heterophile antigen. It is present in all species except rabbit. Present in all species except rabbit. Okay. So now I will discuss a bit about biological classes of antigen. Before that, we can discuss a bit about adjuvant. What is adjuvant, by the way? Adjuvant is any substance that increases the immunogenicity of an antigen. Any substance that increases the immunogenicity of an antigen, if you add, like for example, yesterday we have discussed why DPT is used together, which acts as an adjuvant, the pertussis component. The LPS of pertussis, lipopolysaccharide of pertussis, is a adjuvant for DT and TT. Similarly, DT and TT act as adjuvant for Haemophilus influenza B. Alum is one of the best used adjuvant. Alum. Similarly, Fluent's adjuvant. Fluent's both complete and incomplete adjuvant, they are example of classical example of adjuvant. Other than that, Mycobacterium, Bovis, okay, non-bacterial product like silica, beryllium, thiomersal, all these are non-bacterial products, they also can act as adjuvant. Mineral oil, very simple adjuvant is oil, mineral oil, this also can be used as adjuvant. Okay, so the list of adjuvant is very important. Which of the following is not an adjuvant, they may ask. biological classes of antigen, they say that antigens are of two type, T dependent antigen, T independent antigen. There is a third category of antigen is there, which is called a super antigen. How all of them they differ from each other? Most of the antigens are example of T dependent antigen. This is a normal antigen. Any antigen when it enters, first it is grabbed by APC, which is called as antigen presenting cell, then which will process the antigen and will present to a T cell. T cell will secrete certain cytokine that will activate the B cell to produce antibody. So this is a normal pathway of any antigen to be processed. What is a super antigen? How it is different from T dependent antigen? They say that the super antigen, they are supernormal. They bypass APC. They do not require the help of APC. Instead of that, they bind to a specific receptor of, I mean, they can directly bind to a specific receptor of T cell, which is called as variable beta region of T cell receptor. They directly bind to the variable beta region of T cell receptor. This binding is, remember, this binding is non-specific, and this leads to production of enormous amount of cytokine. Various non-specific cytokines will be produced, massive release of cytokine. That in turn can cause polyclonal activation of B cell, and which in turn can produce hyper gamma globulinemia. This can cause hyper gamma globulinemia. This is super antigen. What is a T independent antigen then? T independent antigen, they bypass what? These antigens, they bypass APC as well as they bypass T cell. That means where they bind? They directly bind to B cell. B cell will have surface immunoglobulin like IgM or IgD. These are the surface immunoglobulins. So they directly bind to the surface immunoglobulin, and again this binding is non-specific, and non-specific binding leads to again polyclonal activation of B cell and hyper gamma globulinemia. Polyclonal activation of B cell and hyper gamma globulinemia. Can you tell me what are the example of T independent antigen? We have discussed one yesterday. Capsular antigen. Apart from that, flagellar antigen and LPS or endotoxin. LPS or endotoxin. So these three are classical example of T independent antigen. Fine. And we have not discussed example of super antigen. The super antigen examples like staphylococcal toxins, like epidermolytic toxin, enterotoxin, toxic shock syndrome toxin, streptococcal toxin like streptococcus pyogenic exotoxin, then mycoplasma arthritidis, Yersinia enterocolitica, Yersinia enterocolitica, viruses like Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegalovirus, HIV and rabies nucleocapsid. Of course, fungus like Malassezia furfura. All these are the example of super antigen. So, okay, so this is about the first chapter, I mean first section of this chapter, then antibody. Antibody is Y in shape. First we will discuss about the structure of the antibody. It is Y in shape. It has got two heavy chain and two light chain. The two light chains are, one is kappa, other one is lambda. In any antibody, they are either kappa light chain or lambda light chain, but never both. They say that both the light chains are of same type, either kappa or lambda type, but never both. Similarly, heavy chain are of 5 type. And depending upon the type of heavy chain, the immunoglobulin is classified. This is called as isotypic. They are called as isotopes. All the 5 immunoglobulins are called as isotopes. And which heavy chain is there, accordingly the immunoglobulin is classed. For example, if it is mu, immunoglobulin is called as IgM. Okay. So, if the heavy chain is gamma, anti immunoglobulin is called as IgG, alpha IgA, delta IgD, epsilon IgE. So they say that all the 5 classes of immunoglobulin, they vary from each other in their heavy chain, especially in their constant region of heavy chain. All 5 classes of immunoglobulin, they vary from each other in the constant region of heavy chain. This variation is called as isotypic variation. This variation is called as isotypic variation. Okay. Sometimes they ask about enzymatic digestion. Various enzymes where they act, and that leads to a production of how many fragments. So the junction is called as hinge region. Junction is called as hinge region. They say that there are 3 enzymes: papain, pepsin, and mercaptoethanol. Papain act above the hinge region. Just above the hinge region is the site where papain act. Okay. So this leads to generation of what? 3 fragments. Upper 2 fragments are called as FAV region. Down fragment is called as FC region. So 2 FAV and 1 FC are produced. FAB, F for fragment, AB for antigen binding. Antigen binding fragment. FC is constant region or fragment of crystallization. Pepsin, it acts below the hinge region. This is the site where pepsin acts. So that leads to production of both the FABs are joined together. So 2 FAB dash. This is a single fragment, both the FABs are joined. So, from this to this will be one fragment will be produced, 2 FAB dash plus the down portion is so less that they will be disintegrated into small pieces. So, 2 FAB dash, when FAB, pepsin will act, it leads to a production of 2 FAB dash. Mercaptoethanol, what it does is, you know that all these chains, all the chains, 4 chains are joined together by disulfide bond, and mercaptoethanol breaks the all disulfide bond will be broken down. So that leads to a production of 4 separate chains, 2 heavy chain and 2 light chain, all the 4 chains are separated from each other. Okay, so this is one thing what they ask. Second, they ask is which chromosome codes for which chain of hemoglobin. They say that all the entire hemoglobin is not coated by single chromosome, and that adds to the antibody diversity also. Different part of hemoglobin is coated by different chromosome. For example, light chain kappa and light chain lambda are coded by chromosome number 2 and 22, whereas heavy chain is coded by chromosome number 14. So this adds to antibody diversity. They say that different chromosome will synthesize the chains, and after that the recombination will take place. Okay. So as I told you earlier, immunoglobulin will have two FAB region and one FC portion. FAB region is what? Antigen binding fragment. You know that the light chain and heavy chain are further divided to a variable region and a constant region. And in light chain, the variable region and constant region is of equal length, whereas in heavy chain, which is longer, the constant region is much longer than the variable region. Fine. And inside the variable region, there is an area called as hypervariable region. Inside the variable region, there is an area called as hypervariable region, VH, hypervariable region. Inside the hypervariable region, there is another area called as paratope. Paratope is another area present inside the hypervariable region. Okay. And paratope is a site which binds to what? Epitope of antigen. Paratope is a site which binds to epitope of antigen. Can you tell me one thing? Antibodies can be generated against antibodies, true or false? Yes, because if I inject horse immunoglobulin to you, your body is foreign to horse immunoglobulin, so it can produce antibodies against horse immunoglobulin. That means antibodies should have certain epitope like structures against which antibodies are generated. Those epitope like structures are called as idiotope, and they usually are located inside the paratope. So these are called as idiotope. These are called as idiotope. Okay, idiotopes are the antigenic determinant of an antibody against which antibodies are synthesized. Antigenic determinant of an antibody against which antibodies are generated. Okay, so this is how they vary from each other, and you need to remember. Now let us discuss the properties of all the five classes of antibody. We will start with IgG. IgG antibody is highest for DHS. DHS stands for highest daily production, highest half life of 23 days, and highest serum concentration. In all these three properties, IgG is highest. IgG is responsible for precipitation reaction and neutralization reaction. It also binds to classical complement. It also binds to phagocytes to mediate phagocytosis. This is also the antibody that binds to NK cells to mediate ADCC. What is ADCC? I will tell you little later. Just write down ADCC. It binds to NK cell to mediate ADCC. It is the antibody that is secreted in placenta as well as in breast milk. Breast milk also, which other antibody? IgA. Okay. And IgG antibody, say that it appears late, hence indicate chronic infection. Hence indicate chronic infection or even past infection also. Can you tell me how to differentiate chronic infection and past infection? Both the condition IgG will be there. First you will have acute stage IgM, then go to chronic stage IgM will become IgG, then you will recover, then also IgG will be there. So based on IgG, how will you differentiate it is chronic or it is past? They say that you have to do a test called as IgG avidity test. What do you mean by avidity? Avidity is the strength of a bond. The strength of any bond, the strength of any relationship increases with time or decreases with time. With time the strength of a bond increases. So they say that if IgG avidity test shows that the avidity is low, then it is relatively earlier infection, that is chronic. If the avidity is strong, then it is a remote infection or a recovery, past infection. So IgG avidity test is done to differentiate chronic and past infection. They say that avidity increases with time. So between chronic infection and past infection, which comes early? Chronic. After that a past infection. So avidity is low for chronic, strong for past. There are some exceptions in IgG properties, you can remember. IgG secreted in placenta, of course, yes, except which IgG? Which IgG does not secrete in placenta? Say that except IgG2, IgG2 is not secreted in placenta. IgG binds to classical complements except IgG4. IgG4 does not bind to classical complement. They say that the sequence is 3-1-2. Highest complement binding is 3, then 1, then 2. And in fact, more than IgG3, the best binding is IgM. Okay, this is the sequence what you have to remember. Classical complement, most efficiently IgM will bind, followed by IgG3, 1, 2. This is the sequence what you need to remember. IgG also mediate co-agglutination reaction, again except IgG3. IgG is also responsible for mediating co-agglutination reaction except IgG3. Okay, so these are the properties of IgG. Let us now discuss IgE. IgE is the only heat lover antibody. And you know that it is lowest for, they say that the IgG is highest for what? DHS, D for daily production, half life and serum concentration. They say that for these three properties, for dairy products in half life and serum concentration, the decreasing order is Gande. That is, IgG is highest, followed by A, M, D, then E. In IgG also, highest is IgG 1, followed by 2, then 3, then 4. So, here you can write that IgE is lowest for DHS. For daily products in half life and serum concentration, IgE is lowest. IgE is of course is raised in parasitic infection, especially helminthic infection. It is also the antibody responsible for hypersensitivity type 1. It is also called as Reagin antibody or homocytotropic antibody. That is, homocytotropic means species specific antibody. Okay, then IgD. IgD has highest carbohydrate content and it also acts as surface immunoglobulin like IgM. Both IgM and IgD act as surface immunoglobulin. They will be present on the surface of B cell. Surface immunoglobulin. Then IgA is second highest for what? DHS, that is daily products in half life and serum concentration. It is of two type, serum IgA, which is usually monomeric in nature, and mucosal or secretory IgA. This is dimeric. Dimeric means what? How many antibodies? Two antibodies. So, what is the valency? So, two antibodies. Each antibody has a valency of 2. See, valency means how many FAB portions are there. Each antibody has 2 valency. So, IgA, 4 valency. Secretory IgA, 4 valency. Dimeric. So, they say that the 2 antibodies, the 2 secretory and dimeric antibody are joined together, of course, by a J chain. J chain is a chain that usually joins the multimeric antibodies. But apart from J chain, it has one more joining segment which is called a secretory component. Secretory component. And the secretory component is synthesized by local mucosal epithelial cells. So, this is MCQ what they ask, which part of the antibody is not synthesized by the plasma cells. Plasma cell is the cell which secretes antibody. All the chains, light chain, heavy chain, J chain, everything is synthesized by plasma cell, except the secretory component of IgA antibody, which is synthesized by the local mucosal epithelial cells. Okay, then IgM. IgM is highest for MIS. MIS stands for highest molecular weight, highest intravascular distribution and highest sedimentation coefficient. Highest molecular weight, highest intravascular distribution and highest sedimentation coefficient. And IgM, they say that it is responsible for agglutination reaction. IgM is responsible for agglutination reaction. It is also the first antibody to raise, hence indicate recent or acute infection, primary infection. And in congenital infection also, in uterus also, it is the first antibody to raise, first antibody in fetus. Hence, it indicates true congenital infection. It also binds to classical component. Classical component, what is the sequence I told? IgM is highest, followed by IgG312. Okay, so all these are various example of the various properties of the different antibodies, very important for exam. And IgM is, you know that it is multimeric. You say that IgM is pentameric in nature. A pentameric means how many antibodies? So what is the total valency? 10 FAV, so 10 valency. And all these 5 antibodies are joined together by J chain. J chain is the chain which joins the multimeric antibody. Okay, so this is all about IgM. Then a bit about abnormal immunoglobulin. Abnormal immunoglobulin, like for example Benz zone protein. Benz zone protein is a abnormal protein synthesized in multiple myeloma. And this multiple myeloma is a condition where defective or cancerous plasma cell will be there. And this kind of plasma cells are defective, they do not synthesize heavy chain, they synthesize only excess light chain. So these Benz zone proteins are nothing but they are the accumulation of excess light chain, and such light chains, they are excreted in urine, serum, I mean they are present in serum and excreted in urine, and they have a property of getting precipitated at 50 degree centigrade, but again they can redissolve at 70 degree centigrade. They gets precipitated at 50 degree centigrade, but again they get redissolved at 70 degree centigrade. Benz zone protein, this is the example of abnormal immunoglobulin. Like that, other abnormal immunoglobulins like heavy chain disease, this is the disease where the excess heavy chains will be produced. Cryoglobulinemia. Okay, and Waldenstrom macroglobulinemia. So all these are other conditions where the abnormal immunoglobulins will be produced. Fine. So this is about abnormal immunoglobulins. Then now we will discuss a bit about monoclonal antibody. This is again important. What do you mean monoclonal antibody? These are antibodies produced by single clone of plasma cell. Single clone of plasma cell. And there is a procedure which is devised by Dr. Kohler, for which he got the Nobel Prize also. And that procedure which is devised to produce monoclonal antibodies called as hybridoma technique. hybridoma technique is the method to produce monoclonal antibodies. And how it is done is, they say that the procedure a bit is required for you. So, whatever antigen against which you want to prepare a monoclonal antibody, you inject into mouse. Okay. For example, you want to prepare HBsAg antigen. So, this I mean you want to prepare monoclonal antibody against HBsAg antigen. So, what you do is you inject HBsAg antigen into mouse. Give a period of 2 to 3 week gap so that the mouse will start sensitize, the B lymphocytes of the mouse will be sensitize against the antigen and start producing antibody. So, after 2 to 3 week gap, you collect the B cells from mouse spleen. You aspirate the mouse splenic aspirate, which will have plenty of B cells, which are sensitized against the antigen injected. So such splenic B cells, they are normal cells, they will die in some time. So, though they produce the antibody of interest, but they cannot produce antibody for longer time, because any cell will die in some time. So, if you want to prepare monoclonal antibody for longer duration continuously, then you have to make these splenic B cells immortal. How you can make this splenic B cell immortal? By fusing this splenic B cell with myeloma cells. Myeloma cells are cancerous B cells, they are cancerous plasma cells. So, the cancerous plasma cell, if you fuse with normal B cells, then in the reaction chamber, three type of cells will be there. In the reaction chamber, fused hybridoma cell will be there. Apart from that, unfused splenic B cell and unfused myeloma cell also will be there. So, the next step is purification step. You have to remove the unwanted cell. Next step is purification step. You need to remove the unwanted cells. So, that can be done. That can be done by subculturing onto a medium called as HAT medium. HAT medium is a specialized medium composed of hypoxanthine, aminopterin and uracil, thymidine. So, when you subculture the fluid into HAT medium, what happens? Which cell survive, which cell die, which cell will not grow? So, these are the three MCQs what they ask. Now, a bit of biochemistry knowledge is required. You know that purine synthesis in any mammalian cell, purine synthesis occurs by two methods. Normally, it occurs by a de novo method, but if the de novo method is blocked, then there is a Salves pathway also. So, de novo pathway is usually blocked if you add aminopterin to the medium. Aminopterin, if you add, it blocks the de novo pathway, and HAT medium contains aminopterin. So, any cell which is growing in the HAT medium, that cell has to perform which pathway? Salves pathway. Salves pathway requires an important enzyme called as HGPRT enzyme. This is a very special enzyme which is needed to perform the Salves pathway. And this unfused myeloma cell, myeloma cells are defective cells, they are cancerous cells, they will not have property of normal cell. They say that this kind of cells, they lack HGPRT enzyme. Because they lack HGPRT enzyme, they cannot grow on HAT medium. What happens? Unfused splenic B cell, they grow, because the Unfused splenic B cells are the normal cells. They will have SGPD in them. They can grow. But they die soon. Why they die? They are not immortal. They will die soon. The fused hybridoma cells, they grow because of the B cell component. And they survive long because of the myeloma cell component. So that is how you are purifying the hybridoma cell from the mixer. So this is the procedure called as hybridoma technique. This is a technique by which monoclonal antibodies are produced, and this method has been devised by Koller. Okay. So other than that, they ask, there are four type of monoclonal antibodies: mouse monoclonal antibody, chimeric monoclonal antibody, humanized monoclonal antibody, and human monoclonal antibody. What I have given you example now is mouse monoclonal antibody. It is completely synthesized in mice. So mouse monoclonal antibodies, the problem is because they are foreign to human being, so there is every chance that we will produce antibodies against the monoclonal antibodies, so that those monoclonal antibodies, when you receive it, will be destroyed. See, why monoclonal antibodies are given? They are like immunoglobulins. How you are preparing rabies immunoglobulin? They are monoclonal antibodies. So if you prepare in mouse, they are foreign to us. So if I inject you a rabies monoclonal antibody which is prepared in mouse, you will develop antibodies against that, and immunocomplex mediated rejection will take place. So those antibodies are called as HAMA cells. HAMA means human antibodies, human anti-mouse antibodies, human anti-mouse antibodies. So because of human anti-mouse antibodies, this mouse monoclonal antibodies are not much useful to us. So they, because 100% they are mouse derived, whereas chimeric monoclonal antibodies, they say that this kind of monoclonal antibodies, the variable region is mouse derived, the remaining part is human. The variable region is mouse derived, the remaining part is human. Okay, like this, only the variable region is mouse derived, whereas the remaining part is human. They say that the 34% are mouse protein, whereas the rest is human protein, so that the reactions will be less. Humanized is even less. Humanized is only 10% is mouse derived. 10% means only the paratope. Like, you know that in an antibody there is a specific area inside. If, for example, if this is a variable region, inside the variable region the hyper variable region is there. So inside the hyper variable region, the paratope is there. Only the paratope is mouse derived, only the particular point against which antibodies are generated, I mean which will react with antigen, that only part is mouse derived. That is only 10%. The remaining 90% is human derived, whereas human monoclonal antibodies are 100% human derived. So mouse 100% mouse derived, human 100% human derived. Chimeric 34% mouse derived, whereas humanized only 10% mouse derived. So this is all about monoclonal antibodies. So now we will discuss the antigen antibody reaction. Antigen antibody reaction broadly, they say that any antigen antibody reaction, the common property, the general properties are, it has to be specific. It involves the specific epitope of antigen binding to specific paratope of antibody. And there are various non-covalent bonds, interactions takes place. They sometimes ask, when an antigen binds to its antibody, which and all are the various bonds by which they are bound to each other? Answer will be various non-covalent bonds like hydrogen bond, hydrophobic bond, electrostatic bond. One more aspect what they ask is, what is the difference between affinity and avidity? See, for example, if an antigen has got multiple epitopes, and when it binds with multiple antibodies, when an antigen has got multiple epitopes, when it binds with multiple antibodies, affinity is defined as the bond between single epitope with its antibody, whereas avidity is the total strength between all the epitopes with all the corresponding antibodies. So, this is the difference between affinity and avidity. Affinity is the strength between single epitope with its antibody, whereas avidity is the total bond between all the epitopes with its corresponding antibody. And one more principle of antigen antibody reaction is, they work on the principle of Marek's hypothesis. Marek's lattice hypothesis. What is lattice hypothesis? They say that when antigen reacts with antibody, the antigen reacts with this antibody, say that antigen antibody reaction occurs best when the numbers are equal to each other. I will tell you one example. Suppose you take a test tube, take patient serum will have plenty of antibodies, yes, then you serially dilute the patient serum with normal saline. So gradually the more antibodies will be there in the first tube. When you serially dilute, the antibody level will come down. Okay. After that, you add equal amount of antigen to all the tube. So, which tube the numbers are equal? Middle tube the numbers are equal. So, they say that the antigen antibody reaction occurs at its best. Agglutination will be properly, it will occur, or precipitation will occur properly. That means the lattice structure which is formed by the binding of antigen antibody, that will be firm when the numbers are equal to each other, which is called as zone of equivalence. Whereas the reaction fails to occur, the reaction is weak or fails to occur if the numbers are excess, either antibody excess or antigen excess. Both the condition the reaction fails to occur. Antibody excess is before the middle tube or after the middle tube. That is why it is called as prozone phenomenon. Prozone phenomenon is antibody excess before the zone, whereas antigen excess is called as post zone phenomenon, whereas the reaction occurs only in zone of equivalence. So there are three zones, the reaction occurs only in zone of equivalence, whereas prozone and post zone, both the condition the reaction doesn't occur properly. Okay, so this all these are about the antigen antibody general principles. Then we will discuss about types of antigen antibody reactions. The types of antigen antibody or reactions, first we will discuss about the conventional reactions, the conventional and newer reactions. Like that we can classify into two half. Conventional reactions are like precipitation reaction, agglutination, neutralization, complement fixation, all these are conventional antigen antibody reactions, traditional reactions. Newer reactions are like ELISA, all that, what we will discuss a bit later, ELISA, immunofluorescent test, okay, radioimmunoassay, Western blot, all these are rapid test, all these are newer methods. So let us discuss the conventional methods first. To start with, conventional method to start with, precipitation reaction. Precipitation reaction is when a soluble antigen reacts with its antibody at a particular pH, temperature and electrolyte. It forms insoluble precipitate. And this insoluble precipitate will be formed in the form of flocule if you use a liquid medium. If the medium is liquid, then flocules are formed. In the form of band, it will be produced if you use a gel containing medium. So this is the definition of precipitation reaction. And accordingly, precipitation reactions are defined or can be classified as reactions in liquid medium and reaction in gel containing medium, that is precipitation in gel. Liquid medium examples are ring test. Ring test is Lancefield grouping and Ascoli is thermoprecipitation test. Lancefield grouping is done for Streptococcus and Ascoli's thermoprecipitin test is done for anthrax. It is very old test, not done now, anthrax. Then slide flocculation test and tube flocculation test. Slide flocculation test VDRL, RPR, tube flocculation test, Kahn test, both are done for syphilis. Precipitation in gel, what is the problem of liquid medium? Liquid medium will become dry soon. You cannot preserve it for a longer time. And also it is difficult to interpret the flocules. Whereas if you use a gel containing medium, it is easy to interpret. And it can also be preserved. Preservation is possible. Example of precipitation in gel. There are various examples like radial immunodiffusion, LX gel, precipitation test, Aiken test to detect E. coli toxin. E. coli toxin is detected. All these are examples of precipitation in gel. Again, the problem of precipitation in gel is, gel, the movement of antigen and antibody movement is extremely slow. It will take around 2 to 3 days to complete the reaction. So, in order to reduce the time, there is a modification is done, which is precipitation in gel in presence of electric current, so that the movement will be faster. This is called as electro immunodiffusion. And the variant of this is counter current immunoelectrophoresis, rocket electrophoresis. All these are variant of precipitation in gel in presence of electric current. Okay, so this is all about precipitation. So what is the definition of precipitation? Which antigen it uses? Yes. In contrast, agglutination uses insoluble or particulate antigen. Example, there are various examples like slide agglutination test, tube agglutination test, like Weidel test, then standard agglutination test, SAT. Standard agglutination test is done for Brucella, standard agglutination test, where MAT is done, microscopic agglutination test, Leptospira, cold agglutination test, where Mycoplasma, then Coombs test. Coombs test, it is done for RH incompatibility. And in this particular test, they say that you are detecting RH antibodies in serum. If you are detecting RH antibodies in fetal serum, you have to do a direct Coombs test. If you are detecting in maternal serum, you do a indirect Coombs test. So this is how agglutination reacts at examples in Coombs test. Okay. Then comes indirect agglutination test, indirect or passive agglutination test. Which is more sensitive, agglutination or precipitation? By definition, agglutination is always more sensitive and easy to interpret than precipitation reaction. That is why always they try to convert precipitation reaction into agglutination reaction. That can be converted by using a carrier molecule like RBC, latex, etc., and you can coat the antigens on the surface of the carrier molecule. The soluble antigen can be coated on the surface of carrier molecule to make it insoluble. Such preparation, when it is added with patient serum containing antibody, the antigen antibody reaction occurs on the surface of carrier molecule, and which is called as passive agglutination or indirect agglutination, because you are using a carrier molecule as a base. Example of this is, there are various examples, indirect heme agglutination. If you are using RBC, it is called as indirect heme agglutination test, or even latex agglutination test for antibody detection. Okay, all these are passive agglutination. So passive agglutination test, what is coated, what is detected?
antigen. What is detected in patient serum? Antibody. You can do reverse also. You can coat on the carrier molecule, you can coat antibodies. That can be used to detect antigen in sample. This is called as reverse passive agglutination test. And if you are using RBC, it is called as reverse passive heme agglutination test. If you are using latex, it is again latex agglutination test for antigen detection. And even co-agglutination test also is an example of reverse passive agglutination test. Co-agglutination test. In co-agglutination test, the carrier will be staph aureus on which IgG will be coated, which is used to detect the antigens in the specimen. Fine. So this is about agglutination test. Then certain example of complement fixation test like Wasserman test. Conglutinin test. Complement fixation test is also used for rickettsia, mycoplasma, chlamydia, brucella and various viral diseases. Of course, please remember it is obsolete. Now, complement fixation test is only there in books, that is all. It is outdated test. Similarly, neutralization test also is almost obsolete. The various example of neutralization test like viral neutralization test to detect antibodies. Then Schick test, which is done for diphtheria. Previously, anti-streptolysin O antibody was detected by neutralization test. Now, of course, we do lattice agglutination test, but previously it was detected by neutralization test. Naegeler reaction. Naegeler reaction also is a toxin. So, the last three are the example of toxin, antitoxin, neutralization test. Schick test, ASLO and Naegeler reaction, all these are example of toxin, antitoxin, neutralization test. Okay. So, this is all about conventional method. Now, we will discuss about newer method. Newer method, as I told you, ELISA, immunofluorescence assay, chemiluminescent immunoassay, okay, Western blood, rapid test like immunochromatographic test and flow through assay and immuno electron microscopy. So, like that there are various newer methods, and please remember newer methods are more, I mean it is increasingly used than the older methods. Older method agglutination is still in use, precipitation almost obsolete except VDRL and CFT and neutralization tests are also obsolete. So, newer methods are widely used now, and all these newer methods they vary from each other by the molecule used for labeling. See, the principle is very simple. All the newer methods, what principles they have followed is either antigen or antibody, you coat with a detector molecule. If you want to detect antigen, you coat the antibody with a detector molecule. If you want to detect antibody in specimen, you coat antigen with a detector molecule. When antigen antibody reaction will take place, because of the detected molecule you can visualize the reaction. So, very simple principles they followed, and they vary all these methods, they vary from each other either by the molecule which is used for labeling or how you are going to visualize the reaction. How you are going to visualize, whether it is a color change or it is a fluorescence. Like that, how you are going to visualize the reaction? These are the point based upon which your it is different. Like for example, ELISA enzyme is used to label. Immunofluorescent assay, fluorescent dye is used. Chemiluminescent immunoassay, various chemiluminescent compounds are used, like luminol, acridinium. All these are chemiluminescent compounds. Even one thing what I have left is radioimmunoassay, RIA. Radioimmunoassay, the radioactive isotopes are used to label, and because isotopes are used here, hence, because of the radioactive hazard, this method is not used much, because there is a risk of radioactive hazard. Western blot also is slightly different. It is also enzymes are used, but it is slightly different. You are detecting the antibodies against individual component of antigen. Okay. So similarly, a rapid test, immunochromatographic test, they say that colloidal gold is used to label. Flow through assay, most of the flow through assay, staphylococcal protein A is used as a conjugate. So like that, various methods, various molecules are used to label. The basic principle is almost same. Okay. So this is all about. They are the normal serum protein. Constitutes around 5% of serum protein, and they are antigen non-specific. That is, their level do not increase or decrease following antigen exposure. Their level do not increase or because they are antigen non-specific, and also they are species non-specific. Of course, they are heat labile, and they have a property of binding to Fc portion of antibody. Okay, there are three pathways. What are the three pathways? Classical, mannose binding or lectin pathway, and alternate pathway. The differences between the three pathways is a frequently asked MCQ. I'll tell you first classical, then I will explain the other two. Classical pathway. Can you tell me which of these three pathway is antibody dependent? They say that classical pathway alone is antibody dependent. Mannose binding and alternate pathway is antibody independent. So when an antigen comes in classical pathway, first the respective antibody will go and bind. Which antibody will bind? Either IgM or IgG312. And to the Fc portion of the antibody, the first complement will come and bind. And in classical, the first complement to be activated is C1. I will tell you a very easy code. Please remember, 142 is extra required for classical. Okay. Whereas 42 is extra required for mannose binding. Alternate binding 142 not required. 142 not required. This is a code what you have to remember, so that it is easy to reproduce in exam. So what happens is, the first complement is C1. The first complement, you can have a look on the last, that is 72 number page, so that it is easy to mark also. So the first complement is C1, which will come and bind. C1 in turn will activate C4. C4 will activate C2. C2, once it is activated, it will activate C3.
and C3 in turn will activate C5. Once C5 is activated, C6, 7, 8, 9 will join the part, and all together it is called as membrane attack complex. Why? Because it will attack the membrane and it will form pore that lead to lysis of the microbial surface. Alternate pathway, how it is different? Alternate, the antigen of alternate pathway is usually LPS or endotoxin antigen. LPS or endotoxin antigen is the usual antigen of the alternate pathway. And this antigen, when it comes, they say that it is antibody independent, does not induce, I mean it will not bind to antibody. What it does is, it will act on the free C3b, the free C3b which is present in the serum, that will be converted to activated C3, that will be converted to activated C3. And this occurs through a series of activator, like for example, first factor B is activated, then factor D is activated, then properdin is activated. So, all these are the intermediate activators, following which finally C3 is activated. And once C3 is activated, the remaining pathway is same, that is the remaining pathway is same. Mannose binding pathway is that, they say that mannose antigens are specialized lectin, I mean they are the carbohydrate antigens on bacterial surface. Mannose antigens are specialized carbohydrate antigen on bacterial surface. So, when these type of bacteria will enter, first they will bind to host lectin, once they are bind to host lectin, the mannose binding pathway is activated, and the mannose binding pathway is exactly same as classical except the first step. What is the first step of classical? Which complement is activated first in classical? So, you remove that, remaining same, that means first C4 is activated, then C2, then the remaining pathway is same. So, this is the outline of the complement pathways. So, if you are done with the outline of complement pathway, then I will tell you the differences. The differences are antibody dependent. Which is antibody dependent? Classical is antibody dependent, where lectin and alternate are antibody not dependent. That is why they say that classical is a part of acquired immunity, whereas lectin and alternate the pathway are part of innate immunity. Okay. The first complement to be activated, in classical is C1, alternate C3b, lectin C4, first C4 is activated. Then also they ask the complement level. Complement level, easy to remember, is whichever complements are utilized, though that level will be decreased. If a complement is not utilized by the pathway, it will be normal in their level. Like for example, in classical, C1 to C9 all are utilized. So, the entire all complement level will be decreased. In lectin, which is not utilized? C1 is not, so C1 will be normal, other decrease. Alternate pathway C1, 4, 2 not utilized, they will be normal, other will be decreased. So, by this you can know which complement pathway is activated. Okay.
Then we can discuss about some of the complement deficiencies. Complement deficiencies, like for example, early complements, like C 1, 2, 3, 4, early complement deficiency leads to increased pyogenic infection and increased SLE. Similarly, late complement deficiency, like the membrane attack complex, if this level is decreased, that leads to increase Neisseria and toxoplasma. Okay, and there is one more important complement deficiency, that is C1 esterase inhibitor deficiency. If C1 esterase inhibitor deficiency takes place, that leads to increase C1 esterase. C1 esterase means it is the active C1. If active C1 is increased, that means that leads to classical pathway will be activated, the whole classical pathway will be activated, and that leads to increase production of C2B, and C2B has got kinin like activity, and that leads to production of a very important condition called as angioneuritic edema. Increased kinin like activity is responsible for edema in angioneuritic edema. Okay, so nothing but, I mean broadly you can remember that C1 esterase inhibitor deficiency leads to angioneuritic edema. Okay, so all these are various complement. We will start now the next chapter, structure of immune system. So the structure of immune system, as far as the lymphoid organs are concerned, lymphoid system can be classified into lymphoid organs and lymphoid cells. Lymphoid organ, it could be primary lymphoid organ like thymus and bone marrow, or it could be secondary lymphoid organ like lymph node, spleen and MALT. MALT is mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. Lymphoid cells, it could be T cell, it could be B cell, NK cell, all these are lymphoid cells. They say that there are other associated cells of immune system, like for example the phagocytes, such as macrophages, neutrophil, basophil, eosinophil, dendritic cells, mast cells, all these are other cells of immune system. And don't forget the cytokines also, they are the component of a lymphoid system. Okay, so let us now start the first part, that is lymphoid organs. Start with thymus. Thymus is a embryo, it is an organ which is active in embryological, in the embryonic life. It is mainly active during embryonic life, and they say that it is developed from 3rd to 4th pharyngeal pouch. And it is divided into outer cortex, inner medulla. Okay. So they say that both cortex and medulla are rich in thymic lymphocytes. Thymic lymphocytes are called as thymocytes. And apart from that, in cortex, Husserl's corpuscles will be there. Husserl's corpuscles will be specialized, they are degenerated, specialized degenerated
epithelial cells present in cortex called as Husser's corpuscles. Apart from that, nerve cells also will be there. Nerve cells are specialized cells which are lymphoepithelial cells. Lymphoepithelial cells which are called as nerve cells. What is the role of thymus? Thymus, the role is maturation of T cells. We say that the progenitor T cells they are originated from bone marrow, then they enter into the thymus, for further development. This usually occurs in the embryonic life. How the development occurs, I will tell you now. The progenitor T cells will be transformed into double negative T cell, DNT cells, that is double negative T cell. Why they are called double negative T cell? Because they lack both CD4 and CD8 cells. Okay, and double negative T cells will further transform into double positive T cell. They will acquire both CD8 and CD4 molecules, and the double positive T cells, what happens is, the fact of double positive T cells is like that. They say that the 95% of double positive T cells, they undergo apoptosis. This is called as death by neglect. They undergo death by neglect. Why? Because these double positive T cells, they do not recognize MHC. You know that any antigen, if it comes, it is processed by APC. The big antigen is fragmented into small antigenic fragments. Then the smaller antigenic fragments are presented on the surface of MHC to T cell. That means T cells should be capable of recognizing MHCs. Then only it will recognize the antigens present in the MHC. So, majority of the T cells, they do not recognize MHCs, hence they undergo apoptosis by a process called as death by neglect. Remaining 5% will be positively selected. In that 5%, 2 to 5% will undergo negative selection. Why? Because those 2 to 5% of T cells, they say that these T cells, they are self-reacting T cells. Self-reacting T cells means what? T cell who react towards their own antigen. That will lead to autoimmunity. You will produce antibody against your own antigen. So 2 to 5% of T cells will undergo negative selection because they are self-reacting T cells. The remaining 2 to 5% of T cells, of double positive T cells, they will lose either CD4 or CD8 to become mature single positive T cells, that is CD8 T cell or CD4 T cell. So, that is how the development of T cells occur in thymus. Okay, so then I will tell you what happens in lymph node. Lymph node is a peripheral lymphoid organ. Lymph node is a bean shaped peripheral lymphoid organ. Again, it is divided to outer cortex, inner medulla, and in between cortex and medulla there will be paracortical area. Say that it is a cortex and medulla, both these area are rich in B cell, both are called as B cell area.
whereas is a paracortical area where the T cells they reside. So the T cell area of lymph node is nothing but paracortical area. Okay, so if this is cortex, this is medulla, this is cortex, then in between cortex and medulla you will have a zone which is called as paracortical area, and the paracortical area is a site where the T cells will be there. Similarly, spleen. Spleen is the largest secondary lymphoid organ. Okay, and spleen, as you know, spleen is, the splenic arterioles will be supplied to various areas of spleen. Okay, so here how you know that spleen has a white pulp and a red pulp. Red pulp is the area where the sinusoids will be filled up, the blood will be filled up in the sinusoids. The remaining area is called as white pulp. Okay, the remaining area is called as white pulp, and you know that this central arterioles, just adjacent to the central arterioles, the zone this is called as periarteriolar lymphoid sheath. Periarteriolar lymphoid sheath, and this is the area where the T cells will be residing. And adjacent to periarteriolar lymphoid sheath, the next zone is the marginal zone. Just next to the periarteriolar lymphoid sheath, the next zone is the marginal zone, and marginal zone is the area of spleen where B cells will be residing. So both these areas are under white pulp. The remaining part of the spleen is filled with what? Blood. The remaining part of the spleen is filled with blood. That is the red pulp area. Okay, so this is all about the T cell and B cell area of spleen and lymph node. Then coming to MALT. MALT is what? Mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. They are lining the GI mucosa, mainly GI mucosa and also the respiratory mucosa. They are either loosely organized, in GIT they say that either they are well organized, called as paired spaces, this is present in submucosa, or in lamina propria of GIT they are present as loose clusters of lymphocytes. Okay, so the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue, either they are well organized as paired spaces which are present in submucosa, or they are loosely organized in lamina propria as loose clusters of lymphocytes. In this context, I have already told you the epithelial cells are modified to form M cells. They say that some of the epithelial cells are modified to form M cell. What is M cell? Yes, M cells are modified epithelial cells where they will have flat villi. The villi are shortened, and instead of that they will have basolateral pocket which are reached in lymphocytes and macrophages. And M cell is the site of entry of many organisms like Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio, Polio, etc. Many organisms are there, many enteric pathogens are there which entered through M cells. Okay, so this is all about mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. Then we will discuss about immune response. Before that, I will tell you a bit about MSC, because the knowledge of MSC is required to understand immune response. How many MSC molecule are there? MSC is what? Major histocompatibility complex. They are located in the chromosome number 6, short arm of chromosome number 6. There are 3 MSCs, 1, 2 and 3. MSC 1 and MSC 2 are involved in antigen presentation. They are involved in antigenic presentation. They say that MSCs are extracellular or intracellular. MSCs are extracellular. For example, MSC 1 is present mainly in the outside of the cell. They will have an intracytoplasmic tail, but the majority of MSC 1 and MSC 2 are outside. MSC 1 has got 4 extracellular domains which are named as alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 and beta 2 domains. Whereas MSC 2, the domains are, distal domains are alpha 1, beta 1, the proximal domains are alpha 2 and beta 2. What is the role of MSC? If you see, the role of MSC is antigen binding. As I told you earlier, if you remember, when an antigen comes, it will be captured by APC, small cell antigenic fragments, and the smaller antigenic fragments will be presented on the group of MSC to what? T cell. Okay. So you can have a look here. It is a group of, so if they ask the peptide, antigenic peptide binding area is, antigenic peptide binding area of MSC, if they ask, then the answer is, for MSC 1 it is a junction of alpha 1, alpha 2. This is the area where the peptides will come, the antigenic peptides will come and bind like this, and it is a junction of alpha 1 and beta 1. This is the peptide binding domain for MSC 2. At the same time, one more function of MSC is, a part of MSC will be bound to either CD4 molecule or CD8 molecule. You know that MSC 1 will present the antigen into CD8 T cell. MSC 2 will present the antigen into CD4 T cell. So they say that in MSC 1 it is the alpha 3 domain which binds to CD8 molecule of cytotoxic T cell, and in MSC 2 it is the beta 2 domain which binds to CD4 molecule of T helper cell. Okay, it will be difficult to understand, but when I tell immune response, these things will become even clear. They ask which part of MSC has which responsibility, which part of MSC binds to antigenic peptide, which part of MSC binds to CD4 or CD8 molecule. Let us discuss immune response so that these points will be clear. And of course, what is the role of MHC3? MHC3 is not used in antigenic presentation. Instead of that, MHC3 it codes for various complement proteins, various proteins which are used in immune response, like complement proteins like C2, C4, C3, convertase, properdin, all these are coded by MHC3. Apart from that, heat shock protein, okay, tumor necrosis factor alpha, beta. So genes for all these proteins are located in MHC3, so they code for all these proteins, but they are not involved in antigenic presentation. Fine. So this is the one question they asked. And where MHC1 and MHC2 will be located? MHC1 is located in all nucleated cells, whereas MHC2 is located only on apices, only on antigenic presenting cell, antigen presenting cells. Okay, so this is a knowledge of MHC, what is important for you to understand about immune response. Okay, now you tell me very simple question. Immune response, of course, is of two types, CMI and AMI. AMI is antibody dependent immunity or humoral immune response. CMI is cell mediated immune response. First question is, CMI and AMI, individually you tell, CMI and AMI, they are part of acquired immunity. Both these statements are true or false? CMI is a part of acquired immunity, true or false? False. AMI is a part of acquired immunity, true or false? True. Second question is, CMI is mediated by, only mediated by cytotoxic T cells, true or false? False. Then what are the other cells that can mediate CMI? Natural killer cell, excellent. And ADCC. So now you tell me, if it is mediated by cytotoxic T cell, then that will be acquired immunity, specific. If it is CMI mediated by a natural killer cell, it will be non-specific. And also ADCC, both are part of innate immunity. So CMI is acquired or innate, or maybe both? Both. It's a part of both. Now you tell me, last question, T helper cell, it is required only for CMI, true or false? They say that antigen grabbed by APC presented to T helper cell, followed by T helper cell will differentiate into TH1 or TH2. Cytokines of TH1 will activate CMI, cytokines of TH2 will activate AMI. So how can you say that T helper cells are only for CMI? T helper cells are nothing but, they are the central regulatory cell of immune response. They say that they are the Lord Krishna of immune response. What Lord Krishna has done in Mahabharata? he has participated in the war? No. But the entire war was regulated by him. So T helper cell by himself, it doesn't participate in CMI or AMI. CMI, the effector cells are cytotoxic T cell, NK cell, ADCC. They only will finally they will mediate CMI. They will destroy the cells. Similarly, for AMI, the affected cells are B cells, which will produce antibodies, and antibodies will neutralize the antigens. So they are the affected cells. They are the people who will participate in the war. But the entire war will be controlled by T helper cells. So T helper cells are like that. They are the central cells which will regulate the immune response. So now we will discuss about immune response. We'll discuss first about the broad outline of immune response is like that. When the antigen is presented, it will be grabbed by the cell, either the APC or maybe the any host cell, and it is presented to T helper cell. Usually you write down APC only, you write down. It is grabbed by the APC and it is presented to T helper cell. Then T helper cell will be activated. Activated T helper cell will secrete Th1, Th2, Th1 cytokines will mediate CMI, Th2 cytokines will mediate AMI. So this is the central outline of immune response. That means from antigenic exposure to activation of T helper cell, this much is common pathway. This much is there for AMI as well as AMI. So let us discuss this first, followed by this. That is, first we will discuss antigen presentation, then we will discuss T helper cell activation. So antigen presentation is of two types: extracellular antigens are grabbed by APC and they are presented to T helper cell by endocytic pathway. The pathway is called as endocytic pathway, and in that APC, which MHC will help? MHC2 will help. Similarly, intracellular antigens, viral antigens, tumor antigens, all these are present inside the host cell. All these are present inside the host cell. So inside the host cell, intracellular antigens are present. Any host cell, the inside that, the intracellular antigens are present. So they are presented to cytotoxic T cell by MHC1, and this pathway is called as cytosolic pathway. There are two pathways of antigenic presentation: antigenic endocytic pathway and cytosolic. You have to easy to remember is extracellular antigen endocytic pathway. Okay. So now let me tell what happens in the common pathway. Common pathway says that T helper cell will be activated. This is the last outcome of the common pathway. So how T helper cell will be activated? First antigen will come. The antigen will be grabbed by APC. APC will phagocytose the antigen. Antigen will be phagocytose, then process the antigen into small antigenic peptide, then presentation of the antigen on the surface of MSC 2, and this presentation is presented to T helper cell. T helper cell will have T cell receptor. This will bind to antigenic peptides, binding number 1, binding number 1. It will have CD4 molecule. This will bind to a part of MSC2 molecule, binding number 2. Which part of MSC2 molecule? I have told you, alpha A, beta 2 domain, beta 2 domain of MSC2 molecule. And T helper cell will have a co-stimulatory protein, that is CD28, which will bind to B7 molecule of APC, B7 molecule of APC, binding number 3, binding number 3. Once these 3 binding take place, the T helper cell will be activated, and here one more influence will be there. The fourth interaction is APC will secrete, cytokines like interleukin 1. This will act on T helper cell for activation. This is the fourth stimulus. Interleukin 1 will be released by APC and will act on T helper cell for stimulation. Once all this stimulation will fall in place, T helper cell will be activated and it will be differentiated. First activated, followed by differentiated to, please remember, either or, never both, either Th1 or Th2. Okay, up to this is a common pathway. Suppose if the antigen is a extracellular antigen, I mean the AMI to be activated, then in such case the T helper 2 will be differentiated. Suppose this is a intracellular antigen, viral antigen, tumor antigen, in such case T helper Th2 will not be activated, Th1 will be activated. So depending upon what you need, accordingly the appropriate limb will be activated, either Th1 or Th2. So this much is common pathway. Now let us discuss, suppose if it is intracellular antigen, then how CMI takes place. If it is an intracellular antigen, then of course you know that Th1 will secrete various cytokines like interleukin 2 and interferon gamma. Interferon gamma is a macrophage activator. It will activate the resting macrophages to activated macrophages. And activated macrophages can phagocytose and kill the antigen. Okay. Whereas interleukin 2 is a T cell growth factor. It will activate the growth and differentiation of various type of T cell like its own cell, T helper cell, autocrine effect. It will activate its own cell, cytotoxic T cell, delayed type of hypersensitivity T cell, as well as it is an NK cell growth factor. It will activate even the NK cells. So all these cells will be activated by interleukin 2. So now I will tell you, and in this context I will tell you the cytokine produced by Th2 also. Th2 will produce cytokines such as interleukin 4, 5, 6, 10 and 13. All these cytokines will activate the B cells to produce respective antibodies. For example, interleukin 4 will induce the production of IgE. Example, like that, various antibodies are produced by various cytokines. Okay. So now I will tell you how CMI takes place. CMI takes place when the antigen is intracellular or extracellular. CMI, intracellular. So intracellular antigen means they are present inside the host cell. Either they are virus infected cells, or they are tumor cells, or they are any other intracellular antigens like Mycobacterium tuberculosis, intracellular. So first step is those intracellular antigens are processed inside the host cell into small antigenic peptides, and they are presented on the surface of MHC-1. Then they are presented to which cells? Cytotoxic T cells. Cytotoxic T cells will have T cell receptor binding number 1, which will bind to antigenic peptide. Will have CD8, which will bind to MHC-1, binding number 2. CD28 binds to B7 molecule, binding number 3. And before this, the T helper cell already would have been activated. Okay. Before this to happen, the first step is activation of T helper cell. T helper cell already would have been activated, and T helper 1 would have been differentiated, that would have produced interleukin 2, because interleukin 2 is required for CD8 activation. I mean cytotoxic T cell activation. So this is the cytokine stimulus, that is number 4. So these are the 4 interactions which will take place. Okay. So first T helper cell activation will occur. So this is the common pathway. Then interleukin 2 will be produced. After interleukin 2 is produced, the same antigen is processed and presented to cytotoxic T cell. Then here interleukin 2 response is there. Then only after all this response, the cytotoxic T cell will be activated. Finally, the Kumbhakarna will get up from sleep, and once it gets up, Kumbhakarna means what? He is always blind in its action. His role is to kill. He will not see to whom he is killing. Yes or no? So cytotoxic T cell, it will secrete perforin and granzyme. Two enzymes it will secrete, perforin and granzyme. These are the two enzymes secreted by cytotoxic T cells, and these cells and these enzymes, they will blindly act on host cells, because host cells will carry the intracellular antigens. So perforin will form pore through which the granzyme will enter, and the granzyme, once it enters inside, it will destroy the intracellular antigen. Along with that, host cell destruction also will take place. So that is why I told there it is an example of Kumbhakarna. It will destroy its own host cell also. Okay, so this is how cytotoxic T cell will take place. And please remember, expression of cytotoxic T cell, I mean activation of cytotoxic T cell, or cytotoxic T cell to work, the antigen has to be presented along with MHC-1. If host cell doesn't have MHC, you know that MHC-1 is there where? MHC-1 is there in all nucleated cell. RBC doesn't have MHC-1, non-nucleated. Or even a nucleated cell, they say that viruses and tumor antigens, the viruses and the tumor antigens, they have various technique to suppress the MHC1 expression, because they know that if the host cell will have MHC1, then it is dangerous. Cytotoxic T cell will come and kill them. So they will do certain mechanisms by which MHC1 expression will be suppressed. So now you tell me, if MHC1 expression is suppressed, then Kumbhakarna will not get up. Then how those cells will be killed? How those viruses will be killed? Here's the importance of second line CMI defense, that is NK cell, come into play. They say that how NK cell will work, I'll tell you. NK cell has two receptors. NK cell has two receptors. This is a host cell, this is one more host cell. NK cell usually have two receptors on its surface: activation receptor and inhibition receptor. Two receptors it will have on its surface. In a normal circumstance, inhibition receptor is the dominant receptor, and inhibition receptor usually binds to MHC1 molecules. That is how inhibition receptor will be stimulated. So any host cell which will have MHC1 molecule, the inhibition receptor will bind to MHC1 molecule and NK cell will be suppressed. For the normal circumstance which will have MHC1 molecule, and NK cell will be always in a sleeping state. Even if a cell is virus infected or it contains tumor antigen, if MHC1 expression is not inhibited, then also NK cell will not get up. He will not get up. Let the cytotoxic T cell will come and kill. I will not go. But those cells where MHC1 expression is suppressed, there is no MHC1. Either the virus infected cell or the tumor cell will be suppressing MHC1 expression, then in such situation MHC1 is not there. If MHC1 expression is not there, and of course this viral antigens, they will be processed into small peptides. Tumor antigens will be processed into small peptides, and they will directly coat on the surface. If MHC1 is there, then it will bind to the inhibition receptor and NK cell will be dormant. But if MHC1 is not there, then this viral antigens and the tumor antigens which are coated on the surface, they will bind to this activation receptor, following which NK cell will be activated, and NK cell will again secrete the same two enzyme, perforin and granazyme, and it will mediate similar kind of destruction, Kumbhakarna kind of destruction, like what cytotoxic T cell will do. The final mechanism of killing is same. Fine. There is a third mechanism also. So CMI, the first mechanism is through NK cell, through cytotoxic T cell. Second mechanism is through NK cell. Third mechanism is through ADCC. ADCC is one more mechanism. Here what happens is, the host cell carrying the virus antigen or the tumor antigen, they will be processed into small peptides, and these viral antigenic peptides will be coating on the surface of the host cell. You know that antibodies have no role if the antigen is intracellular. True or not? antibodies can neutralize only the extracellular antigens. If the antigens are inside, then they are handicapped. However, antibodies can kill those host cells carrying intracellular antigen by ADCC mechanism. What is ADCC mechanism is, as I told you, the antigens, the viral and the tumor antigens will be coated on the surface, and they can be bound to the respective antibodies. Antibody will come and bind to the surface antigens. Fc portion of the antibody will be free, that can be bound to various affected cells like NK cell, macrophages, eosinophil and neutrophil. These are the four affected cells of ADCC, by which the affected cells are activated and they will secrete their products. For example, NK cell will secrete perforin and granazyme, macrophages, eosinophil and neutrophil, all these will secrete various lytic enzymes. All these will again destroy the host cells carrying the intracellular antigen. So, this is called as ADCC, that is antibody dependent cell mediated cytotoxicity. It is regulated by antibodies but mediated by cells. Which cells? Neutrophil, eosinophil, macrophage, NK cells. All these will mediate and they will produce cytotoxic effect in the host cells. So, ADCC is again a part of CMI, but it is directed by antibodies. So, that finishes your CMI. Then AMI, as I told you, I have already told you, when the antigens is extracellular, processed by APC, presented to T cell will be differentiated to Th2 will secrete certain cytokine that will activate the B cell. And detail if you want to know, then I will just outline, I will not go into the detail. What happens is, B cells will be there first in the form of centroblast. So, all this will be happening in the germinal center of lymph node, germinal center of secondary lymphoid follicle. So, in the germinal center of secondary lymphoid follicle, B cell first will be there in the form of centroblast. Centroblast is a form of B cell that will transform to centrocytes. Centrocytes will be captured by follicular dendritic cells, so that the particular centrocyte will be selected. Selection of the centrocytes will take place by follicular dendritic cells. Then, once the centrocytes are selected centrocytes, they will be centrocyte means what? They are the type of B cells. So, those B cells will again interact with the activated T helper cells. T helper 2 cells will be activated, no? Those T helper 2 cells will be interacting with B cells, and the particular cytokines what it secretes, that cytokine will be acting over the B cell. As a result, B cell undergo class switchover to produce antibody. Do not go into the details, just outline you have to remember. B cells undergo class switchover to produce antibody. What do you mean by class switchover? This is something they ask. Class switchover means, you know that first antibody to produce is IgM. Any B cell, the first antibody they produce is IgM. After some time, the same B cell, instead of producing IgM, it will start producing any other class, retaining the antigenic specificity. That means the FAB portion will be constant. Only the FC portion will change from IgM type to any other class type. So, this is called as class switchover, and this occurs as a result of specific cytokine stimulus produced by the T helper cell. Each cytokine is responsible for stimulating the B cell towards a particular class. Okay. There is a table in the book, you can see later which cytokine will stimulate which class of antibody. Okay, so this is how the antibody mediated immune response takes place. That finishes this chapter.